Actually, most of the question that you already discussed in your beautiful presentation, starting sometimes from Mike. Yeah, just most of the people that get afraid from the headache that they have.
I have headaches now. I missed my coffee.
So one of the question that they're asking about the aspirin for the protection, and Dr. Rahman is already illustrated that beautifully. What is the size and the imaging quality that we just insisting that most of the patient they we like to go for conventional cerebral angiogram.
If you allow me, Fawaz, for the size, Abdurrahman mentioned something important that you know the all the statistics talk about 7 millimeter or 10 millimeter, there is a tendency to treat any aneurysm that is 3 or 4 millimeter. In fact, in our population, there are studies from the region that are looking at most of the aneurysm ruptured are smaller aneurysms. So that gives us have to be careful. If you see the 3 millimeter aneurysm or 4 millimeter aneurysm in our population, in our region, we have to be careful not to transport all the literature from the Caucasian or North American papers to our population, because our regional data support treating even smaller aneurysms. So that is something to take into consideration.
I agree with Hassan. This we call the size paradox. So 70% of ruptured aneurysms are less than 7 millimeters. Can you take this piece of information to justify treating all small aneurysms? The answer, we don't know. Some people are using that argument to push for treatment in smaller aneurysms, like the 4, 5, 3 millimeters, taking this piece of information and trying to use it to paint all small aneurysms in the same paint and color, which I think it's dangerous. But unfortunately, we don't have this link in the literature. Who's going to rupture of those small aneurysms? Until now, data is not helpful, really.
So what is your approach to a 4 millimeter aneurysm, realistically, right now, in someone who's a saccular aneurysm, well-rounded aneurysm, good aspect ratio, good size ratio? So it's a low-risk aneurysm by aneurysm factors. What would be your approach in a 4 millimeter aneurysm in someone who's like 32?
The age is a big risk factor for me. I would push for treatment. Uh-huh. And smoking is a huge risk factor. It's a huge risk factor for growth, not only for rupture, but also for growth. So it's not a dose related. It's an exposure related. So regardless of how many cigarettes you smoke, the incinerating factor is there for growth and rupture. So if he's a smoker and young, I will push for treatment for this 4 or 5 millimeter aneurysm, despite it's against all the scores that we put in.
Yeah, and we have an anecdote about this. One of the patients I've seen in my practice with a 4 millimeter aneurysm, he's a smoker. So I told him, you have to stop smoking. He was pushing. He was like, oh no, I need to be treated. I want to get rid of this thing. So I told him, okay, you stop smoking. We'll see you in a year. So he came in a year later. The aneurysm is the same, but he looks darker with darker lips and he's coughing and huffing and puffing. He actually doubled his smoking because he wanted this aneurysm to get worse. So I will be forced to treat him. It's like a kind of a reverse prevention on his part. So I told him, don't do this. The aneurysm behaves on its own. So yeah, so it is an important thing to consider. So we'll always have to have these discussions. And, you know, between us colleagues, we talk to each other all the time, and we do consult each other all the time on these things. And you know, there is a lot of factors that can hinder us, unfortunately, from eligibility to treatment, insurance coverage and insurance approvals and all this. So it's something that really has to be taken into account as well. So there is some logistical restraints or constraints that are beyond the discussion here, but they have to be factored in at one point or another.
Totally agree.
And sometimes patient khira plays a role here. You know, so if a patient tell you that I would like to do khira and come back, go ahead and do khira. And if it's not good, don't come. I believe in patient choice, actually.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wallahi,
I was not planning to join you, but amazing presentation by Hussam Abdurrahman and the moderator Fawaz. One of the best sessions MENASO had this year is this session, more than 1,400 attendees. This is great, Hussam. I have a question, Hussam, if you allow me, Fawaz. Chronic headache. When you spoke about daily chronic headaches, Suhail had a red flag above his head. I'm seeing in a daily practice tens of patients per week with daily chronic headache for a years and a years headache doctor from one modality to the another. Rarely I will do brain imaging for them, and when I will do brain imaging for them, I will do plain CT MRI without contrast, no MR angio. Hussam, do you think that Suhail should change his practice? Do a CT angio for these patients and send them for Fawaz to do a diagnostic conventional angio to rule out any aneurysm there? Any criteria to help us to decide with these chronic headache what to do from neurosurgical part?
Well, thank you for this well-chosen question to put me not in a corner, like in a corner with a fire in it. So no, but for real, the one of the things that push towards investigation in the vascular direction is the nature of the headache. So migraineurs, they have the headache, but they describe the development of the headache over a period of few minutes. But the ones who are vascular in nature, they are abrupt. The onset of the headache is abrupt. So if the person describes like a shock to the head or a nail to their eye or something, I would be worried. So it's the way that the patient describes it. The headache builds up gradually, then you're right. You will not need to image them. Just put them on one of the medications and trial of another medication, a third medication, so on. But if the patient describes, and here it becomes that we all talk about the science, the scales and whatever, but there is an art to what we do. And I learned this from neurologists, actually, the details of the history, the way the patient describes the chosen words. If they say a nail to my head and they're smiling, you know something is wrong. But if they say a nail and you see the grinch in their face, just remembering that headache is something to take into consideration. And I will use that singular criteria to escalate vascular imaging.
And vascular imaging, you mean here a CT angio, MRI, or?
Any CTA or an MRA, they have a pickup rate of almost 2 to 3 millimeters. So it's all similar. Okay. If you are looking for, and I think the MRI help is more helpful if you're looking for other causes. So if you're looking for the details of the other headache syndromes, MRI will be better.
Sure. Yeah. So I think if the headache is not fulfilled the criteria or very classic for migraine and tension headache for more than one year, so I will ask for MRI and MRA without contrast just for screening. I think this is an approach that I learned from neurologists as well. So it will relieve the patient at least that I screened them with a modality without contrast and without radiation.
Let me put the question the other way around. If you screen the patient and you found with a mild headache, non-specific, and you found a 3 millimeter aneurysm, it is very difficult to convince them that this aneurysm is not really the source of their headache.
I agree.
So I send them back to neurology.
Yeah, that's why you have to choose carefully.
Yeah. But headache more than 1 year is sometimes let the patient think psychologically undisturbed, you know, psychologically disturbed.
Yeah, well, sometimes I would do this and I prime the patient that, you know, there is 98% chance that this MRI will be negative. So, you know, I cleared that. So I'll talk about the 2% that's in the autopsy studies. And I'll just, you know, if it happens, you're not like, you're one of the general population, you don't really fit the criteria. But I would not do it liberally. I will wait. Send them to a good neurologist specialized in headache. And if they come back, I will image them.
Excellent. So I really enjoyed the night with this excellent talks and discussion between colleagues, actually. I think there is nothing more. The question, and they are repetitive. So if you want to just say final words, Dr. Abdurrahman, Dr. Hussam, Dr. Sahel, and Dr. Mike, co-chair.
So I would like to thank Abdurrahman, Hussam, and Fawaz. I received many WhatsApp enjoying what's Hussam presented. Dr. Abbasi, hope he finished his OR, and he's still there. Poor guy.
Yeah, he's still there.
So, Allah. 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 So. So thanks for three of you. I promise that we will have you before the end of the year again to run one of these wonderful sessions, Abdurrahman and Hussam. And inshallah, we'll see you soon. Jazakumallah khair.
Jazakumallah khair,
Habibi. Thank you.
This session will be put on the YouTube channel of MENASO. It will be available for free. And next session will be next month in the first week of April. If Eric can run the video, which will be also from Saudi Arabia before we move back to UAE and Dubai. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Habib. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a nice night.
Shayala. Fama illa Abdurrahman. Fama illa Hassan.
يلا السلام عليكم.
زورونا في الإمارات. شكرا جزيلا.
الله يسعدك. فكوا لنا بس الدرب.
نفك لكم كل حاجة. يا مرحبا. السلام عليكم. Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Eric. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Dilraj.
Thank you, Doctor.